Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is a regularly scheduled meeting of Sunderland Board of Selectmen and the Finance Committee. It's March 20th, 2017. Let's call the order at 6:43. Mr. Bergeron would like to extend his regrets for not being able to attend, but that work thing got in the way. Before I like to start with the meeting, I'd like to take this opportunity to inform the passing of a very kind gentleman. Tom Herrick passed away the other day. Tom Herrick, for those that have been in the town, know Tom was married to Carolyn Perry. Tom Herrick started out as a merchant mariner in the Second World War on merchant ships. He worked his way in a lot of different things. He was in the gallery during the Watergate hearings. He was very involved with politics, both on a local and state and national level. And I would say Tom is one of, and Carolyn both, were two of the kindest people that I've ever known. We didn't always agree, but boy, they were super kind, and they've helped many people. And at this time, I'd like to take a few seconds to offer a remembrance of Tom. Thank you. First up, we have a personnel committee report. David?
Yes. The personnel committee's been working for a little while on reviewing, and trying to get a process in place to set up periodic reviews of positions. So what we wanted to look at was essentially all of the non-union positions, and then see how we compare it to our comps, and then make any adjustments as necessary. And because what we wanted to come up with was a goal to keep our people roughly at the mean for the comp towns for given positions. And then we also had the annual COLA review that we come up with each year with our, based on our calculation. And this year, that came up to a 2% calculation using the standard formula that we've been using for a while. And so that what we've got on this sheet here. Do you guys all have copies of it over there? Okay. All right. Now, okay, good. So what that total will represent in the back is looking at those positions, what it would take to bring those up to the mean of all the compositions, and a 2% COLA, which we normally look at for that. So you've got two different components in there. And one of the things that we're trying to look at, too, and this is, as we've discovered trying to do this, this is kind of a grueling process because you've got some towns that don't have similar positions. And as and one of the things we were talking about, too, is this, which actually we didn't factor into this because you actually don't have that number, is how long a given person has been in a position. Because when you do a comp with another town, you typically just find out, okay, here's position X. Here's what the salary rate is. And there's a lot of different things to factor into that. So so this is what we came up with here. But one of the things we also want to do is get a programmatic process in place, like we have with the COLA calculation, so that we look every, and we were discussing between 3 and 5 years, so that we regularly go out, do the reviews, and then say, okay, if you've got a position that's below a certain amount, and it kicks a threshold off, it's dropped below slow, a certain amount, then you'll want to look at maybe adjusting that position accordingly. So that's what we've got here. And this is essentially the maximum amount. This includes the increase and the COLA. So what we wanted to do is at least present it all at once so that we've got it there, and then obviously have the discussion, and I want to make sure that we have it in light of all of the other budget things that we've got to look at. So. So if you flip over, you can see that the total impact, if you put everything in there at once, would be $41,377.54. And that would be a budget increase of that amount. And then going forward, you'd be looking at whatever COLA you calculate for that year, you know, on top of those positions as they're adjusted.
Okay.
And that, what we tried to do from the, an operative standpoint from the Personnel Committee is to address the fact that we want to make sure from a philosophical standpoint that we keep up, you know, into the mean with our positions relative to the other towns. Getting that to happen mechanically is a separate discussion, but we want to at least get on record that that's how the Personnel Committee felt like we should be treating the employees of the town. Because I think and like a lot of things, is we've just barely got stuff back to where we were pre-recession era. And a lot of these positions have kind of suffered as a consequence after being, you know, dealt with what was left over in the budget after we deal with the other big chunks that come out of it. So that's where we came at with this thing.
So did you calculate through all the towns in the entire state, or did you use
not the entire state. We've gone with a peer group, essentially. You try to look at like size and things like that. But even among that, as Sherry found out, you might get one town that doesn't have a particular position. So sometimes it's a little difficult to come up with that. It's definitely been a challenging process, I got to say, and it's not easy. You seem like you have to reinvent the wheel. And one of the things as I've been going through this is I've looked and I said, there's got to be a better way to do this because it's crazy. You have to reinvent the wheel every X number of years to do it. And it just seems like there has to be a better way in the long run. That's one of the things I'm going to kind of be pushing for, is to figure out a better way to do it.
You didn't look at job duties you just looked at salaries. Like, you didn't look at, for instance, you know, what the requirements are for a truck driver labor with other highway departments.
We didn't get down to doing all this other stuff. Right. We didn't get down to doing a direct, like, you know, I've got
an analysis of
five truck drivers, and I didn't have the five job descriptions from each. You kind of have to go, you know, as a rough thing. And one of the things that we did try to take into account was, like, total comp, thinking about, like, medical, for instance, and things like that, which we're not overburdening folks with that part of it.
And these were the towns you compared them with?
Yeah, that's our review list. Yeah, there. Yep. And then one of the discussions that we had actually at the tail end of last year, too, was periodically looking at what we use for the comp towns. Because, you know, you use a particular set for, you know, since I've known them, we've been using these. So I want to at least talk about, you know, maybe periodically we go out and say, okay, are the comp towns we're looking at, are they the right ones to look at, you know? Because that's a good discussion, too. There's a lot of things to factor into this, and everybody seems to do them slightly differently, too, which doesn't help. So
if you look at, say, the salaries in 2007 before things went bad,
yeah,
union versus non-union, what the percentage increase was from the union people in 2007 to the non-union people, what the difference was. Did you look at that at all?
We didn't calculate out because it gets, you know, depending on which position you're talking about. But typically, this year's COLA, I will say, for the non-union folks is the biggest I've seen it in a long time. Typically, it's been 1.2%, give or take. Yeah. So it's definitely been lower, just looking at this, just COLA only, you know what I mean, than the union positions.
We can get those numbers for you, Bruce. That's a good question.
Because I think that would be, you know, they give you how far ahead one group is than the other group, and you know, I think that's a legitimate thing.
Right, and that's essentially what prompted a lot of this, you know.
Sure, can you put that down, please?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a good, if you can just look at the rough number and say, okay, you know.
Yeah.
And then with union also, depending on positions, you have to look at, there's steps involved, whereas you don't have steps for non-union.
Right.
So, and then we also did talk about, and we looked at some other, like, elected positions, and then also we discussed contracted positions, but you kind of have to address those as each contract comes up and say, okay, you might look at a position and say, all right, position X is below the mean, but we'll address that when we get to the contract renewal stage for that position. So,
how did you look at the elected positions?
Essentially the same way in terms of, like, the salary, and we did a comparison that way. But one of the things that, like, Tom was given a good example of, like, town clerks, you know, you look at just straight salary number, but some town clerks get to keep parts of their fees. So those are other factors you got to look at, too. So
But Bruce, some of your questions are very good, because you don't know, unless you're comparing job description to job description, I kind of think you also have to look at how long this person been in a position.
Yeah, the longevity, oh yeah, yeah.
You know, and personally, I think somebody that's been in a typically, a person that's been in a position in a town municipality for a long time, a lot of times their pay can be less because they've just been getting that 2-2.5%. But someone that's been in a position for a year or two or three, they kind of took that job knowing what the salary is going to be, and that was you competitively went out and hired that person at those rates.
Right.
And I think that competitiveness, you know, so there's people that took that job. So try to make up for it after a year or two, I don't necessarily think it's fair to the people that or didn't apply, because they didn't apply because the job.
Yeah, I understand.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So if you say, well, the job is going to pay $40,000, well, I'm not going to apply. But 2 years later, you get to bump it to $50,000. Is that really fair to the people?
Right.
So you do want to stay consistent also.
It's the same with elected positions. My feeling on elected positions, the salary should stay what it is. Because if you're running for that office, you know what the pay is, and they shouldn't get a cost of living or a COLA or anything like that.
Absolutely. I don't disagree with that.
And if they want to raise, they should present it before the town meeting, because, you know, they don't have hours, they have to work, they don't have this, they don't have that. You know, they're independent, they serve at the pleasure of the people. So.
Agree. Or like, was it Greenfield or one of the cities, it was like, or maybe it was East Hampton. Maybe it was East Hampton that said the mayor was going to get an increase in his salary, but it was 4 years down the road. So you had a time to.
Right, right.
You know, there was a big increase, but it was like 4 years after they voted to do it. So. Any other discussion on salaries, personnel, recommendations? So that's your recommendation there, Mr.
Yep, David? Then we figured we'd take it from there.
Okay.
So.
All right, so Sherry, can you put that on our next agenda to discuss the personnel committee's recommendation? All right. Yes?
Just back there from the library, we just want to say that our ask that as this goes forward, because we know sometimes there are adjustments, could we just be kept in the loop so that if this doesn't go through and present it, that we are just involved in any adjustments that are made?
Mm-hmm. You got it.
Absolutely. That's how we do business, I think, Lauren. Any other? All right. You probably want to talk about the school budget now, huh? I got the mass of humanity here. Your choice, Frontier or Elementary?
Your choice.
First time I ever had a choice for the school department. What's on top here? Frontier.
So we have some new faces on our side, and I see some new faces on your MinCon, so maybe if we could just go around and introduce ourselves so everyone knows who everyone is.
Absolutely. Tom Fadenkevich, Board of Selectmen.
Dave Pierce, Board of Selectmen.
Sherry Patch, Town Administrator.
Elliot Crow, Finance Committee.
Bruce Bennett, Finance Committee.
Francis Mosera, Finance Committee.
Bill Powers, Finance Committee.
Alex Heister, Finance Committee.
Front row.
Dr. Lynn Carey, Superintendent of Schools, Union 38.
Patty Kavanaugh, Director of Business Services for the Regional and the Union.
Bob Doobie, Moderator.
Dear Spiesta, Principal at Frontier.
Ben Barshevsky, Principal at Sunderland.
Dr. Fulton, Chair of the Elementary School Committee.
Casey Shaw.
School Committee. Ethan Farland, Elementary
School Committee, Frontier School Committee. Karen Cardillo, I'm the Director of Special Education for Frontier. Kim
McCarthy, Early
Childhood Coordinator, Sunderland. Jay Harris,
Frontier
School Committee. Okay. Finance Committee, is Sherry doing your minutes for you? Yeah. Is that okay? Sorry. Okay. So we'll have Sherry. Do you need minutes for your, is this, okay.
I don't think we have a form. Do we have a form? Or we do? We did.
Has it been posted?
There's a quorum. We did post it in case, Sunderland is one of the few meetings where we get all of our school committee people, so we do post it just in case. They're not going to deliberate or make any decisions.
What we'll do is, Sherry, could you take our minutes and forward it to the superintendent? And if you guys want to vote on it, that's fine. If you don't want them, fine. That way we'll all be safe. How's that?
Sounds good.
Sherry usually takes detailed minutes.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Copious, that's right. It's a good word for it.
Well, thank you all for coming. Sometimes we get lonely here. Not during budget season, though. Where do you want to start with Frontier?
As a superintendent, I actually was impressed with the Frontier is great in that it has a budget subcommittee. So we met as the budget subcommittee several times. And I think Keith McFarland was on that budget subcommittee. So we met several times before we presented or developed our budget for Frontier. I would like to say that Principal Modesto really worked hard with his team to come up with some cuts that would not impact the programs that the students were receiving, but to help alleviate somewhat of what the budget is coming in at. I will leave the details to Patty.
All right, so this budget is done in two sections, our budget information and our assessment information. If you look on page 436, this is our first page of data. And this is a new sheet that we've added to our budget this year. Dr. Carey added this, and we call it our students and staff data sheet. So on the left-hand side of this is our number of students at Frontier at our last October 1st census. And I leave that frozen because that is what our foundation enrollment numbers are based on. And then below is what we're projecting for next year. And that I do adjust to the current enrollment as we get plus and minus one and two there. As you'll see, we're looking at a pretty significant bump, and we don't know at this point what will come. It's the seventh grade. The next 2 years, seventh grade, it's got a big bubble. So right now there's 145 kids in all of the sixth grades in the Union 38 school. Will we get all 145? Probably not. Historically, we don't. But if we get 120, we're going to be understaffed at the middle school, and we're going to need to add a position. We did not put that in this budget, but we do have money in our school choice for that contingency should we hit that magic number to have to add the additional middle school teacher. On the right, it gives you how many FTEs we have in the building for each position. And as you can see, last year we had 109.47, and this year for 18, next year, we are projecting 107.37, or a reduction of 2.1 positions. Below that are these credentials. This is how our teacher contract works. And these are the degree levels for which they're compensated, and we just gave you a head count of the degree levels of our teachers. Page 5 of 36, this is our little snapshot page that we spend most of our time looking at. And going right to the bottom, you can see budgetarily we're looking for a 3% increase, or $311,859. We had a contract, we're in the second year, next year will be the second year of a 3 year, and it was a 2.5% increase, which adds $166,604 to the budget. Above that, the collective bargaining steps was $69,839.
Patty?
Yes, sir.
Before I go too far, on your reduction in staff, is that through attrition or is that through position elimination? To be determined? Okay, thank you.
New longevity payments added $4,500, and there was a new stipend for teachers who teach advanced placement courses, and that's going to add $15,960 to our budget.
We're increasing our allowance for the non-union salaries by $5,633. Retirement buybacks, we had, last year we were able to encumber them into the previous year, so we had zero. So this year we have a projection of $37,978. We're gonna have the reduction of one instructional assistant, $20,899. Reduction of 0.6 FTE psychologist, $44,925. And we reduced half a secretary for $13,819. That was just the attrition. And we are proposing to move $101,221 of salaries back to school choice. And we'll talk about the school choice in a little bit. We have some other small and large increases to operations. Trash removal, $1,000. Our dues to the collaborative, $2,900. That's not a new expense, but one that was never budgeted, so we're adding it to the budget this year. We're going to be entering a new three-year agreement with our attorneys that will add $2,550. Building inspections, $8,000. This is a line item we are creating because our maintenance budgets never grew with the age of the building. So they're very insufficient for our needs. So if we at least pull out the amounts of money that we know we need for our annual inspections, our pest control, we can then use what's left in our maintenance line for the maintenance of the building. Instructional software, $11,768. This was our virtual high school. Again, that is something, it's not new, but it never got into the budget, so we're adding it. We are adding $15,700 for a school resource officer. The officer has been working in our schools this year, but we agreed last year that we would try to fund it this year, so we're adding the $15,700, which would be our share.
So how was that covered previously?
Last year they didn't charge us.
They didn't charge at all. So Deerfield picked that up last year?
Deerfield is getting...
like who paid? Somebody paid for
Deerfield's
it.
Deerfield's also getting donations from Deerfield Academy. And is that the only school?
Right now, $30,000 comes from Deerfield Academy. It's 180 days. we have them for about 3 to 4 hours a day, unless there's an emergency or some kind of issue. My understanding and my hope is that this will be the only year that we would pay for it.
How would you project to pay for it after otherwise?
I believe that there's going to be a business in town that's going to establish itself that will help with some burden. You know, my understanding is that there will be a medical marijuana dispensary or something that would help support this position. But I don't know for sure.
That's Deerfield.
Yeah. Don't quote me, yeah.
Okay. Just because I figured, just the question, because if, you know, if you say you're going to, somebody's going to want to know, okay, well, where's it going to come from then? Mm-hmm. So, okay. Thanks.
Our Franklin County assessment is up $33,639 due to our increase in wages and also our percent has gone up. Summer services.
I don't mean to interrupt, but this last comment about some business, like a marijuana dispensary, paying for a line item in your budget, I don't think that makes much sense to me.
No, it would pay the police. It would pay the school.
They're
going
to donate
officers.
Money to the police department.
That the donation would
is
pay.
Is there some agreement somewhere, some written agreement somewhere that this will happen? Then how can you bank on that?
Well, next year we will have the discussion again. And then the school committee will be able to decide again whether they want to support it. But this year the discussion was, we believe this will be a one-year payment of $15,000 to support the school resource officer.
So if next year all this falls through, that means this line item, it goes away.
It could, very well. It'll be up to the school committee to decide whether they want it in or whether they don't.
How useful is this program for the school now?
How useful is having a school resource officer to the building? I'm referring you to this high school principal.
I know who he is.
Okay.
I think that it's, the amount of contact we've had with the police department has probably increased over the years just due to I would say, connectivity of towns overall, you know, the way communicating, something happens on the weekends, we're in communication with them regarding our students, getting supports into the school, the students that have been affected by events. That kind of thing has increased. I don't think crime in our school certainly has not gone up. So it is kind of a balancing act of having a cooperative relationship with the police department on those issues. That's kind of basically where it's at. So I was not part of the debate for pro or con of putting this position in, but it seems to be a whole community effort within Deerfield to have a resource officer shared between schools.
That's fine. I guess my point is, if this is something that these kids need and the school needs, I don't think we should base the financing on something as ephemeral as maybe some business will pick this up. And maybe if it's something we need, this business is going to come through next year. I wouldn't want to see this go away because we don't have the budget, because some business that promised, you know, is not keeping their promise. That's what I'm getting at.
Yep, I understand that. What will happen next year if they don't have an alternative funding source, a donation from a business in town? Then they would have to come back to our school committee in February of next year, and they would have to show data and reasonings why this is something the school is needing or the school should have. And then it's up to the school committee to determine whether it's worth $15,000 to our establishment, our school, our organization, to have this particular person in the building. And I do have to say, he does help out with the elementary schools, all four of them, even though he's pretty much, you know, housed or based for a certain amount of time each day at Frontier Regional. If I need him to check on a family or to check on a situation in Sunderland, he calls the right people and he gets the right information for me that helps me make decisions. But it's really in the school committee's hands, and they voted this year to allow it, but next year we're starting again from scratch and they'll have to decide again.
Thank you.
Our summer services line is going up $35,784, twofold. We have more of our special education students in the high school now than we've ever had before. We're reducing our out-of-district. So these students need summer services. And also we lost a grant. We used to get a state grant for summer school, and that was done away with. Our transportation is going up $37,992. And the big one, 145601, that's our health insurance, which you also belong to the Hampshire County group insurance. So our insurance, the two policies went up 10.4%, and our dental went up 8%. At Frontier, the employer bears 80% of that increase. And then we have two small decreases, superintendent office expense, and our out-of-district tuitions are decreasing $100,487. This is something we're going to hopefully continue to see as a trend, that our out-of-district tuitions decrease. Our SPED director, who's with us tonight, Karen Ferrandino, has done an excellent job building programs in our elementaries. So right now, pre-K to 6, we have no children in out-of-district. They're all serviced here in our union school. We still have some pretty big hitters, heavy hitters at the high school level. Some of them have been aging out. We're also providing career transition services for some of our students. So this line will continue to decrease in the next couple of years, but that also will decrease our circuit breaker revenue, which we'll talk about, because that is what's been funding us building the capacity to keep the children in coming up from the elementaries in the high school. So that's the net change, 311,859. If you go to page 18 of 36, I'll talk a little bit about our school choice fund and why we feel we can put the salaries back. So at this time last year when we were doing our budget, and that's the first column, the projected 2017, for the first time, we were upside down. We owed more in choice and charter out than we were receiving. So we had to add $69,788 to the budget and assess to the towns. When we did our first filing in October, that has changed, and right now we're looking at $348,831 worth of revenue. And we did not plan on spending any of that this year, so that we're going to bank. Next year for 18, you can see we're also having a net of 199,151. So if you add those two figures together, we have 547,982 available to spend. So that is where we're going to bring the 101,221 that we talked about from the first page over and fund them on this funding source. And then page 19 is where the additional 113,914 comes from. So circuit breaker, for those of you that don't know, is a program that's the reimbursement is determined through the legislative budget setting process. And if you spend more than four times the state average for one special ed student, you set off the circuit breaker, and then you get a percentage of the excess back. So we've had some pretty big years of out-of-district tuition, so we've been getting circuit breaker money. What we've been doing with that is building new programs at the high school so that we can stop the flow out. But now that the circuit breaker money is going away, we need to find a new funding sources, because we want to keep these programs at the high school so we can continue to not send our children out of district. So we're going to move that shortfall of 114 also to school choice.
Question on school choice. How many kids, students, do you have coming in for school choice, and how many going out for school choice?
Okay, so if you look on the if you look on page 21, that starts the analysis. So receiving right now at the 7-12, we receive 148 students in. And if you go to page 20, I believe it will be 23, that will be our choice out, which is there's 40 students out on choice. And then page 25 is our charter out, which is 42. And then if you look at page 26, I've given you a nice little chart by town for choice at, by numbers, for choice and charter out, and how much it costs each town. So if you look, Sunderland has 11 school choice students and 8 charter, for a total of 19 students. Over on the right, the choice total is 66,264, and the charter total is 148,757. So $215,021 is what the town of Sunderland is responsible, well, not responsible, that's what their students add to this burden. However, because the regional agreement does not address charter and choice, because it didn't exist, the charter and choice gets distributed by agreement. So per the agreement, Sunderland's going to pay $243,922.98. So you're actually, it's to the deficit of 28, that you're paying $28,902 more than you actually should if the regional agreement addressed charter and choice. But you can also see we're in that same dilemma that we're always in. Two towns, it's to their benefit. Two towns, it's to their detriment. If we put it to a vote, it's never going to pass. I'm never going to get three.
I mean, it's the luck of the draw. I mean, you know, it could change. Next year could change.
Right.
You know.
Right.
You don't know.
Yeah.
It's right.
So now we're talking about our assessment data. So if you go to page 29, this is the 5-year enrollment average to determine the assessments. And as you can see, we're dropping out 2011 with 539 kids, bringing in 2016 with only 467, so we're down about 72 students. Sunderland had 137, now you're only providing 109, so you're gonna have a small drop in your assessment this year. But I'm just going to put on your radar that pretty soon this is going to change, because you're the only ones growing. And we're going to see this phenomenon again when we look at our elementary budget, because it's sort of like you're going to get hit twice, because not only are you the only ones growing, but no one else is. They're all decreasing. So it's got to go somewhere.
Can I just step back 1 second to charter schools? What, do you know over the last 5 years what the change out has been to charter specifically, whether it's an increase or a decrease?
I don't have that information, David. I don't know if I can go back 5 years. I can only go back to what I've drawn down from the portal. And I think I've got 4 years of data, so I could go back and do that for you for 4 years. Are you interested in just Sunderland or the Frontier as a
whole? Because I'm curious, because you kind of have to, at some point, you kind of have to try to figure out and extrapolate what your projected outgoing to charters is going to be, say, looking out, say, 5 years for sake of argument. I'm just curious to see how that's affected the numbers overall, because that affects the budget, obviously, and a lot of other things a little bit differently than just a choice out does.
Correct.
You know, so.
What's the average tuition you're paying for a charters?
It depends on the school.
What's the average?
Average about 18 grand.
Per year, per student.
Mm, yeah.
So, Ryan, understand that because we have so many choice students coming in, each student isn't dollar for dollar. So for every choice student that goes in, every charter student that goes out, I have to get three choice students or four students.
Right,
to
make
up the numbers. I just want to say it out loud to the room, because that's the unfair game of the charter system. We build a good product at Frontier, and we have more choice coming in. However, one goes out, I have to get three to replace that in the budget.
And there's we have no control whatsoever what these schools charge for their tuition.
That's correct.
No. That's why I wanted to ask the question, because I want to get those numbers out there, because it's an important aspect.
Whether or not
aspect
for against charter schools, the funding formula is not right.
Right, that's just school? Math.
They're considered public schools under private charter.
Under a charter. They're a public charter.
And the governor did want more of this, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He wanted much more than this. In fact, he did commercials saying that he wanted much more, but it got defeated by...
Right, yes.
One of the things I like to explain is that choice, if we're going to have choice, if parents have choices, and I'm not disagreeing that they shouldn't, then those choices should be funded the same. There should be no difference between a school choice and a charter choice. But the problem is that the school choice is unique to Western Massachusetts and to the Cape, nowhere else in the state.
The school choice.
School choice. Doesn't happen from Worcester over. So we don't have the legislative power to get more than $5,000. It's always been $5,000 since this program's inception. It's never increased. And we don't have the legislative power to get it changed.
So are you saying that, say, in Worcester, they get more if a child left a public school,
nobody utilizes school choice. Once you get past Worcester, they're all small, wealthy towns. So no one's school choicing, so they don't really care.
Because your schools
are all wealthy, and they have more than they can do with. So no one, and they're close together. So nobody's school choices.
As far as the regional agreement is concerned, is there any scheduled renegotiation or meeting on that where it could the question of charters and their expense, or could there a special meeting be called for that?
So Marty, before Dr. Carey's arrival, that was like one of Marty and Mai's last big things. We had to get negotiation, we had like a big checklist, and the regional agreement is the last. And part of looking at the regional agreement is we decided, and it was right before Sherry came, because it was Margaret Nardowitz, that we decided to do a four-town study of building utilization, which was going to give us some results as to, and some recommendations about how we should utilize our buildings, which may lead into talking about either re-looking at our regional agreement, or creating a new region, or creating, you know, expanding the one we have. So that was like 2 years ago, and just last week, after much begging and pleading, we got the report. It's 100 pages. Dr. Carey and I are still going through it. And as soon as we feel that we're comfortable with the information, we're going to disseminate it to the towns. So that warrant article that you approved 2 years ago, we're probably finally going to get a bill for it at some point within the next 6 months. So that's a long
answer to your question. But I think before we talk about anything else, the four towns should get this report, see what it says, and then you tell us what's the next step that you want to do. Do you want to have another four-town meeting like we did when we decided to have it? Mr. Hannon has said he'll come to four different town meetings to talk to you individually, or we'll do a joint one. It's whatever your pleasure is. So as soon as we get that, as soon as we check it for some errors and make sure and completeness, we'll get that out to Sherry to get to you guys.
Because I think what's in there is an important piece of information, or some important pieces of information that we're going to need to actually look at some kind of resolutions to some of these things. Because we've been going back and forth for a number of years and trying to look at other solutions for this and trying to think outside the box a little bit. But
okay, so
one other question. Do you interview the students or the parents of why they're going to charter schools, or no?
So
or you can't
we've been asked
that?
This question before, and when we've done it, we don't really ever get any answers. So we're trying to rethink how we ask the questions to try and get better answers. Because a lot of times it might be, oh, it's convenient. I work in Hadley. I want my child to go to the Pioneer Valley Chinese Immersion School. Or I live up in Conway, close to the border where the Four Rivers Charter School is. So we're trying to create a survey to ask these parents more in-depth, not just why, but how do you, what is your perception that makes you go? So we're going to be working on that.
I think you answered your own question.
Yeah.
It's perception.
Great.
That's all it is.
Great.
I mean,
so what do we have to do to change that perception?
I think it depends on
In this area, I mean, some of the charter schools here, I think, you know, everything else aside about charter schools, there are fulfilling what I think was some of the original idea, which is alternate, like a Chinese immersion school, for example, right? The performing arts school. So that's where it's something that isn't going to be in a typical public school otherwise.
The niche,
right?
Schools.
But well, versus Four Rivers, which I think, I don't know that they claim to have any other alternative other than it's opting that.
Well, without even getting into that part of it, though, it's a valid point. It's kind of like market research in that sense, or like an exit interview. It's important. It's an important piece of information to be able to get a hold of, at least to try to get some kind of tangible answer. And kind of to your point, it's a difficult thing to get. And you're right. There are clearly some people, you know, it's a matter of, you know, where they go to work, where they, you know, their student goes. But it's an interesting thing to get a hold of as far as the information.
To your point, though, but you've got Mr. Modesto who's championing the high school on a regular basis and banging his drum, but he needs a little bit more help.
Right.
And I think that's to your point as well. I mean, that's really what it's all about. It's really about perception. It's a good problem.
We do talk, I meet with each of the principals and I discuss, I go through the list of each my seventh grade class and try to figure out why students are choosing different things. We can look at the actual numbers. It's not like we're losing a dozen students to a certain school and therefore we're not providing it. You have one that has a perception that they want, you know, that Frontier isn't a small school. They want a small school environment. And so they choose to Smith Academy. And I use this example at Waitley. You know, there's some students at Waitley who have gone to Smith Academy Elementary School. I don't know, they're closer to the border there. But really, Smith Academy looks just like Frontier, except we're a little bit bigger with a little bit more offerings. And so I don't understand, you know what I mean? Our sports are in the same conference. We have this, you know, I'd say we probably have more arts at Frontier, but somebody wants a small school. I don't know how to present a smaller school. Frontier is already considered a small school. Yeah. You know what I mean? And so our class sizes are small.
It's a small school.
Frontier is considered a small school. Within the, you know, divisions of athletic alignment, we're considered very small. You know, so it's, you know, that kind of, you know, it's just that, you know, those kind of perceptions where it's kind of hard to, on some of them get, some of them, you know, we're trying to address. You know?
You're not going
to
get everybody, but
you're not going to get everybody, right?
Right. We're, you know, try to collect some of the information you can.
And I think up to this point we've been too vague. Like we just have why, and now we want to niche it down a little bit,
right?
And categorize it a
exactly,
little.
Right. And send them a survey rather than a just, hey, why did you do that?
Can you get can you get help from, say, UMass? You know the.
Just took me 2 years to get one report from
UMass. UMass was used on that report they're talking about.
But you mentioned the schools out east in relationship to school choice. they market themselves as well, and they do it in very discreet and subliminal ways, and it works for them.
And personal opinion, that's what's wrong with our education. We're putting dollar signs on children. And I said that back December 17th, 2006, we had a meeting. I remember we're putting dollar signs on students. And if you look at MCAS scores throughout Franklin County, MCAS scores are not that much different from one school to the other. Charter school, the whole idea about charter schools, it's very easy to solve the problem. Charter schools was to give education, try new different techniques to get people to learn. That was the whole idea about charter. That's a wonderful concept. Simple. Allow the state to pay for that. And more so than the $25 a student that they're giving increase in their budget this year, which was Frontier 611 kids is about $15,000. So the state is contributing $15,000 to the increase to their expenditure to the four towns this year for Frontier.
I think the point I was trying to make is that you need the folks that are going to be utilizing the service, i.e. the parents, to have as much information as they can about the school to then make the choice.
Because it's not just the dollars, it's the public education has now become a competitive environment. Before, you just went to the high school in the town that you lived in. Now you've got choices, so now the high school that you live in, we've got to be competitive. We've got to get out there and market ourselves, which is a whole new issue for us.
And I think we do, in your point, I think sometimes we do a poor job. We should be marketing where our students, not only where they end up going to college, but where they get accepted to.
Right.
We have students that get accepted to some of the most prestigious schools in the country. They may not be able to afford that because of whatever reason, but they're getting in. And we should be, from the highest church steeples, been telling people that. I go down the Cape, and they have a charter school or a school choice on the Cape, and they plaster it on the windows of the main street. You see where every kid is going. Well, not going, where they were accepted. And you'd be pretty amazed at where
Lighthouse
a lot of our kids.
School. I think it's Lighthouse that does that.
Yeah, but be pretty amazed at where some of the kids from Frontier. And it's funny because we have Franklin County Association meeting, selectmen, and people, and they say, well, the problem with Frontier is that no one's going anywhere. And I go, they get accepted, but A, we don't hear about that. We don't sell our kids, and I don't know if that's right or wrong.
See, I don't think it's fair to compare charter schools and public schools. I mean, public schools are, by definition, not supposed to be doing things like selling themselves. They're a neighborhood school where everybody goes if you live in that neighborhood. I think
absolutely
the
Francis.
Idea of charter school in its intent originally was fine. But personally, I'm very opposed to charter schools because I mean, somebody said, you know, it's about the dollars. I think it was you. Today, I think it's all about the dollars. Yeah. Unfortunately, it's not for the benefit of the kids. Those kids that go to charter schools, I don't think that they get $18,000 worth of education as compared to the child at Frontier who gets maybe $5,000 or whatever. You know, I think that any child at Frontier, you know, who gets the same training will do as well as any child in any charter school. I think not.
The charter schools don't have the same requirements that our public schools
exactly.
have.
Exactly. That's
the
my
teachers
point.
Teachers don't have to be as qualified as our teachers.
Exactly.
They don't have all the DESE evaluation.
All the oversights and all.
Everything.
We could go on for hours about charter schools.
We have to be, you know, accountable.
We got to kind of.
So let's bring it back to page 30, yeah. And this is our revenue page. So right now,
can I go back to one thing though? I'm not particularly in favor of having a four town meeting to discuss towns paying. When we send our kids to Frontier, we agreed as four towns that we are going to send our kids together to Frontier, and we all take advantage of the good things. We all and all take advantage of the bad things. And when you start, and this is an old thing that, in my opinion, the school administration past, not necessarily the media past, but has always been trying to pit one town against the other town, okay, on who pays different things. They're all Frontier students, and we all have a responsibility for those Frontier students. So as far as I'm concerned, I may disagree with David on this, but if Deerfield has more kids going to charter this year, well, next year could be Sunderland. And I don't really care because they're Frontier students, and we're all responsible for those students, in my opinion.
Right. It's not us. It's other towns have asked us to do that analysis because...
I understand. Mm-hmm. I just hate pitting. We pit town, one town against another in a budget on something we shouldn't even be talking about. It's
kids are kids.
Right. That's not something I don't think on the table. I got much better things.
It doesn't let us resolve the actual problems.
Correct.
All right, so page 30, the assessments to towns are going to increase by $276,639. Our chapter 70 money increased $11,020, which was $20 per student.
No, I've been at 25.
20.
I don't have to go talk to Charlie about that.
Our excess and deficiency, we're increasing $57,050. Regional transportation decreased $61,308, and our revolving transportation fund up $8,018. Down below, you can see between 17 and 18, the minimum contributions for our towns are decreased $230,995. And just so you know, regional transportation, this is something that is something that's funded again through the legislative process. And we've never really gotten 100%. But a couple of years ago, they promised 100%, and the schools relied on it. And then it got cut in December on 9C, and many regional schools had to do mid-year layoffs. So I'm almost here 5 years. I'm relatively new to the regional. I came from cities. So I budget this very conservatively, because I don't want to get caught in that cycle. So what we do is we budget 50% of what we know we reported on the end of the year report. So anything over, we created the revolving transportation fund. So that money is going to go directly back to the towns at the same percent that you gave it to us. So I'm just going to skip for a minute over to page 34 to show you how that works.
Then I have a follow-up question on transportation.
Okay. So we know that our budgeted transportation is $277,962, but that's not what the 50% is, okay? The 50% of the $107,677 is 50% of what I reported on the FY16 end of the year report, because that's what they base it on. So we reduce it by that, and so the $172,85 gets assessed to the towns at the 18 assessment rate. But we have excess transportation money from 16, $54,641. So the towns are going to get a credit at the 16 rate that they put in at, and then that would be the net assessment to the town for the transportation.
Okay.
That's page
34.
Thank you.
So it kind of softens the blow, essentially, yes, this year.
Right, because what used to happen is anything that came in excess of what we budgeted would then flow through excess and deficiency, mm-hmm, and then we have to see if the school committee was going to vote to give it back. Now it's automatically coming back, which is a much better system, and it makes us feel better that we're budgeting conservatively.
You may not even have this number, but I'm curious, is there a way to judge the impact on another, because you essentially have to project out for all the students for transportation. Mm-hmm. But I think anybody who goes and drops somebody off at a school knows that a lot of parents don't take advantage of the bus. Mm-hmm. Is there any way to get, and it's difficult, but I'm curious to know what percentage we think don't use that, because in other words, we're, and it's difficult to say, because you can't say, all right, well, you know, somebody may say, well, you know, most of the time I drive my kids, but sometimes I need to be able to ride on the bus. And I think just from anecdotal observation, it's pretty obvious that lots of people do drive their kids to school. Mm-hmm. It has nothing to do with judgment, but I'm just curious to know, like, I think in some ways, because we've been trying to grapple with transportation costs for a while, we need to kind of look at that and try to figure out how we can do something about that.
Again, right before Dr. Carey got here, Mrs. Barrett and I were talking about this, because we're talking about the ever-increasing cost of transportation, and the blessing that we have a local person that does it, because the last time we went out to bid,
the next lowest bidder to Mr. Grippo was hundreds of thousands of dollars more. Yeah. We would have never been able to afford it. How do we, how can we now, when we go back out again to bid, we need better data. And how are we going to get that better data? So what we did was we purchased a software called Transfinder. So that is being implemented this year. And at the elementary schools, it's a much easier calculation. You either, they're either taking the bus or they're not taking the bus, and it's basically every day. When we get to the to regional, it's a little harder because we find that our bus ridership in the fall, really low, because a lot of kids play fall sports and they're not going home on the bus.
Yep.
Winter picks up. Yep. Spring falls down again. And it's mostly our student athletes that do and don't take the bus. So we have this new software so that we have better data about our routes. Because let me tell you, trying to find a map, a physical map of Sunderland, Conway, Deerfield, and Waitley, a street map, was a very difficult undertaking. So part of this Transfinder thing, they give you geo, gives us a geo map. So it's much easier. We're going to have more control. We have more information. And so I'll be able to give you some of those statistics. And once I learn how to finesse it. but we've so far got all our kids loaded up, and about once a week I do a training via phone conference with the Transfinder to try and get this thing up and going. So we're going to have some good data for you on that.
Yeah, I think we definitely need some data to be able to figure out, because I saw some nodding heads back there. I mean, it's something you see, but I don't think we've been able to actually grab a hold of it. And
sure, and at the elementary school level, there are times when we have around 100 students picked up in the afternoon.
Yeah.
And if all those students were taking the bus, that would probably add another bus to our route.
Right.
We're two buses right now, and but that's the nature of the elementary school with kids being dropped off.
Yeah.
The elementary school, especially Sunderland, we cut it down from prior to me and Mr. Barshevsky, there used to be three routes. They cut it down to two. We're on the border, possibly needing that third route again with the number of students that we have. And that's something that Mr. Barshevsky and I are looking at, because again, that's going to be another big increase to the budget. So we're trying to hope that it doesn't in that case. Okay, so if we go to page 31, this is just the assessments from the state on minimum contributions based on the changes in foundation enrollment. And then page 32 is the actual assessment. So though the budget's going up 3%, our assessments are going up 3.79. And prior to the school committee vote to put excess and deficiency towards this, it was at 5.94. So what the school committee looked at, 5.94, it was like double what our increase was. So they looked at what we had for excess and deficiency, and they gave half back to the towns. So $157,050 was applied to the assessments, and that is our balance in the excess and deficiency.
So I have a couple questions. The first question is that this year you're looking for 157 from E&D?
The school committee voted to apply $157,050 to the assessment.
And
you can see that on page 33.
And also, I saw that, I think page 8 or 6 or one of those pages, you're going to use like $100,000 from school choice. So that's like $255,000 that you're going to use in non-reoccurring funds. That's kind of not a warm fuzzy feeling to me.
No.
So you keep this year's assessment down.
Right.
But the problem is when you look long term, I mean, $250,000 is a lot of money that not going to be reoccurring. I mean, because it wasn't too long ago, maybe 3 years ago, where the school committee put $0 from the E&D into the school budget, and that killed us. Mm-hmm. But that could happen again if we're not. I mean,
how?
Well, if you don't have as much money going into the E&D as if you're not replacing $157,000. if you're getting tighter and tighter with your budgeting, then you're not putting as much money back into E and D. So now next year, let's say next year the school committee decides not to put 100 and
put any money. We may not have any.
So next year, without doing anything, the budget would increase. Mm-hmm. The assessments, not budget, the assessments would increase by $157,000.
Correct.
If we did nothing.
Correct. So and take the pain this year, take the pain next year.
I'm saying from when my conservative is you try to live within, you try to balance that exposure. Like, how, just as a question, does anybody on the school administration or the school committee know how much that our tax, how much more money we can appropriate this year than we did last year?
We all understand that you're...
It's 140, it's a total.
We don't know the dollars, we know it's
right.
2.5%.
But we can increase our taxes by $141,000 total in the town of Sunderland next year.
Well, you're not going to like our budget for the elementary
school. but that's a number. And that's something that we... So what we try to do is we try to pay for our non-reoccurring expenses with our stabilization or free cash, but not use like E&D as like your free cash. So if you're using $150,000 that may not be coming back next year, we could be setting ourselves up for trouble next year or the year after that. That's all I'm saying. Plus the school choice.
It's a year-to-year game of balancing.
Ooh.
Well, I think you want to try to temper that as much. If you know that something is going to spike up, better to spread it out over a couple of years or try to temper it as much as you can. I think that's one of the things that we try to do, at least at the town level.
The free cash, I mean, the excess and deficiencies is the...
It's essentially free cash in that sense.
The average, I'm assuming the average on those is positive because over the years, but maybe I'm wrong. But the average number, what it winds up coming out.
Since I've been here, we've had about, on average, it's been decreasing because we're budgeting better. So, I mean, all excess and deficiency is how much did we budget and how much did we spend.
I get it. Right. So,
if we're budgeting better, we really shouldn't be holding on to the town's money.
Yeah.
Why are we holding on to it?
Right. We see the same thing as the town.
Budget for what it could be hoping maybe it'll be coming less, but you don't want to budget for less and have it be more.
I look at it this way. I mean, we have people who over withhold their taxes because they like the forced savings of getting a refund at the end of the year. But can you really use your money better during the year?
Yeah, I get that. That's a whole other argument about getting into the quote-unquote soundness and sanity of economic principles. But
I think we do expect school choice students next year. Not as many, but we are expecting to maintain, with the exception of seventh grade, we're not accepting school choice in seventh grade next year because the class is so large, but we'll still have school choice students.
And then the question
hopefully we will, yeah.
I mean when people ask, what is the right amount of school choice students? Well, to me, from a financial perspective, the right amount is the amount that covers the tuition going on.
I think that the concern just in general, and it's not even about why they're specifically caused, is there's a great discomfort of trying to fund ongoing expenses with non-recurring revenue for it.
Correct.
And especially because everybody in this room probably knows is you could come in next year and have a huge increase in special education costs. You could have a decrease too, you don't know, but that's one of the very unpredictable factor sometimes in the budget, and that could hammer somebody somewhere out of the blue depending on what goes on.
So we do have $157,000 in reserve. So if you look on page 32, 36, Sunderland's combined assessment will increase $25,057 or 1.47%. Conway is the loser this year. Theirs is going up 9.93%. You see this. Some years it's Conway, some years it's Sunderland. Some years it's Deerfield, some years it's Waitley.
Yeah, it varies.
It's always two and two.
And this is strictly operational costs, right? Nothing to do with, because capital obviously is going to be a whole other issue.
So part of the rationale of giving half of the E&D back to the towns is that right now we have a problem with the roof that covers the library media center.
I've heard a few things about it, yeah.
Yes. So we're having a study done as to the scope of that. So and this started basically because we received a large private donation to redo the library, the interior of the library media center.
Yep.
And in planning on how we're going to spend that money, we're like, well, why are we spending this money if we're still going to have these leaks that come in? Because anything we purchase is going to get ruined by the rain that comes into the building. So then we started looking at the roof. So our meeting from last week was preempted by Storm Stella. Our meeting is Wednesday night. Yeah. So we're hoping we're going to have a cost estimate, and we may be coming back with a warrant article for the towns to cover that repair and or a borrowing for that repair.
I think the reason I'm just bringing it up is we can talk about these budgets here, but these are operational budgets. We also have to keep in mind capital expenses. And as you alluded to in one other thing, you know, money hasn't been put off for maintenance, has been put off for maintenance and other things. And maintenance is always an ongoing expense. And of course, you know, anybody who drives a car knows the more you put off maintenance, the more you're going to pay the piper down the road at some point. So I'm just trying to frame everything so that we're looking at all of the pieces of the puzzle, not just parts of it.
I had asked our facilities director, Bob Lesko, to come up with a 5-year plan for maintenance and improvements for each building. Mm-hmm. Part of Frontiers was the windows in the Library Media Center. They need to come out regardless. They need to be reglazed and put in. The glazing is falling off.
Right, yep.
And they need to, so the idea being as well, it's kind of like a perfect storm. We receive this gift. We need a boom truck or whatever those things are. You know, they go up high and we need one of those to come and to remove those windows. Well, while we've got that truck there, as we looked closer inside, because it does leak, we needed to find out where the leaks were coming from and how we can upgrade. It's not insulated up there, so we're wasting our electricity through heat and air conditioning in the summer. So there were many things that we looked at to put together an improvement just on this one piece, and it does leak. It leaks over computers, copy machines.
Well, right, everything is there. You obviously want to get to the source of the problem, not treat the symptoms.
And then the third part of it, David, was that while we've got the windows out, do the HVAC units that are in there need to be replaced? Because we might as well do that at the same time instead of paying for the hoist to come back for another 10 grand to take the windows out again when those die. So we're looking at three pieces: the windows, the roof, and the HVAC units that are stored in that area.
We're not sure the HVAC needs to be replaced, but we do need to build kind of a structure that would protect it, that would separate it from the other.
The condensing units.
And we need to put in. We do need to put in a platform so that we can put insulation on, because right now it is the ceiling tiles and then nothing. So we need to.
Okay. So it's important. So for your assessment, we need $25,057 more for this year at Frontier.
Okay. Any more questions?
No. I just have the question about reducing assessment by $257,000 with non-reoccurring funds. So.
Well, wait till we get to the grammar school and you might just change your mind.
Actually, you won't, because if you have all the information, then you can make an informed decision. And if you put that $257,000, if you put it back into the assessment, then you'd actually see what's changing, or how the Frontier budget is changing this year. And so we're saying, well, you know, it's not really that bad, because it's only, you know, we got the $25,000, so Sunderland, we're not going to complain. I get concerned. I hate this word, David. You know this philosophically, because we have that $257,000 that's going to come bite us in the butt next year. I look at the school choice because I look at how some schools are having trouble keeping school choice. And like Deerfield, they're talking about, you know, losing a lot of children in school choice, and
that was their request.
Yeah. So when I look at, I know what happened with Sunderland. How many years ago was it? I mean, we went when we lost our school choice. It hurt our budget tremendously.
It's hurt now.
Right, and so. I'd rather go to the town and say, look, this is what it's really costing, so people see what the actual cost is.
Well, I told them what it would be if they didn't put the free cash on it. And to this being your my last town, you're the only one that says, don't do it.
Well, maybe because we've been around longer, and we you know, if you look at what's going to happen on 1 year, and you hide your head in the sand, but it's going to, I know it may sound crazy to some people and maybe listen for a long time. I hate fighting with the schools because I think education is the most important thing that you can do. I just think we have to be honest with our budgeting for schools.
The budget's only going up 3%. That is an honest budget. It's the assessment piece that's problematic to the
Yes.
towns.
See, in my world, the budget is revenue and expenditures.
Right.
So when I say budget,
revenues are down.
Right. And that's just like now I'm going to get a political thing. But just like when the governor says, we've never spent so much before on education. It's like, I was sitting right next to him. I go, you're giving us $20-$25 a student. It's for Sunderland, that's $6,000 more, or some ridiculous number. I mean, how can anybody look me in the eye and tell me that? In all honesty, you know, I know at one point we were getting 63-64% of our elementary school budget was taken care of by state or other type of grants. Now it's probably like 25% or 30%. I mean, you probably have those numbers. I mean, how much is the state paying? How much is the state contributing to the education of our students, percentage-wise, to what it's costing? It's not a lot. And we used to be at 60%+.
Right, the burden has shifted to the local level.
And I'm saying, why don't we have a 50? Why don't we have a 50-50 partnership here? And we're so far away, and we're going backwards when you talk of regional transportation. Oh my gosh, I mean,
going backward and everything, not just that.
Yeah, so I'm not arguing with you. I understand.
I just do what the school committee tells me to do. I just put the numbers in the spreadsheet.
I understand. I just budget differently, you know.
All right, ready to move on to Sunderland Elementary.
Finance Committee, have any questions about Frontier?
I just, in regards to your comment, I think we all should be starting to prepare for some much more significant cuts coming down the pike. So.
From revenue sources. And so we're going to have decreased revenue, and with the way the population growth is, your assessments are going to increase at a greater percentage than the other towns because you're the only one adding population.
That's just what it is. I mean, that's.
But it's a twofold hit.
That's, yeah. We've been there before. I mean.
Okay. All right. So if we go to page 6 of 28 at the elementary school.
New book. What's Scott's
page
not
again,
here?
Say?
Six.
Scott's page not here tonight. So I got room to put this spread out.
You do.
I can move things over there.
Although I just one quick question: anything you want to plug about new stuff that you are trying to do? Because this is one of the things that I think frustrates a lot of folks is we see increased costs all the time, but you know, how does that compare with what new things that we're doing for the students?
We're not doing this. The Frontier budget, no new initiatives.
Okay.
Sunderland, though, we have some exciting news. May I ask you to speak? Would you like to, or would you rather me?
Oh, I would be happy to speak.
Just in the elementary budget.
Why don't you just come up here so we can all hear, okay?
Well, we had an increased calling for more preschool spaces for our children. And next year, we're opening up two classrooms. We have more applications than we've ever had before. Right now, it looks like we'll be full with 30 kids in each classroom. The breakdown is 7 special education students within a classroom of 15 students. We'll have 2 lead teachers that we're budgeting for this year. And we have varying needs. It's a very, very exciting thing to kind of switch our educational mindset. Your elementary school was first built K through 6, and now we're building the capacity to go from pre-K through 6 with this real integrated way and nice alignment there. So it's we're excited about that. We have a great program.
5 days.
Full day, 5 days a week. And that's really answering the questions of your community. What parents need for children to minimize transitions in the child's day, to maintain high quality, to work on social emotional development and well-being, approaches to play and learning that all supports greater academic functioning, socialization, healthy workforce eventually. So that we're really, really excited about being able to do this. When I first started here 2.5 years ago, we had a morning program and an afternoon program in Sunderland. This year we have a morning and an afternoon program with kind of a mixed group of kids that stay a full day. And next year we will have 2 full day, full week, 8:30 to 3 with an extended care option for families to 5:30. That would be tuition. So we're real excited.
Will there be any revenue for tuition to the early childhood program?
There's always revenue coming in. Never enough though, never enough.
But it does help to offset?
It does offset to a degree, yeah, to a degree. It's parent tuitioned, and we do offer sliding scale. And, the tuition coming in, we're paid in full the staff that we need for the extended care program, and then with your help, we'll keep the teachers and staff doing very well.
I have a question. For special ed children, do they ever graduate? I mean, if a child comes in as a special ed child, do they stay that way throughout their school, their schooling, or do they?
Depends on the disability. Yeah.
Can I answer?
Yes,
please. This is our special ed.
First thing we need to remember is special education children are general education children too. Special education is a supplemental service. So sometimes it's hard to kind of separate them. And then any special education child is very different than the next special education child. So obviously, when you determine eligibility for special education, you need to determine a child has a disability. You need to determine that that disability is affecting their educational progress. And you need to determine that you need special education instruction to make effective progress. Obviously, once you determine a disability, a child does not lose their disability in their life. So you have to take it very seriously when you determine a child is eligible for special education. Because you're not saying they need additional instruction, you're obviously determining disability.
So
thing that changes is with the appropriate instruction, a child may remain to have a disability, but no longer need specialized instruction to make effective progress because they've learned coping skills and they've learned other ways
Thank
to
you.
Work with it, and they can come off of an IEP.
And can then become part of the general population?
They're always part of the general ed.
Thank you.
I guess they're always part of the general ed. They just receive special education instruction in addition to the special ed, the general ed instruction.
And there's no stigma attached to these children in any way.
If I may say, I think this Frontier and Union 38 School District has a very accepting and open environment, and where there's very little stigmatization on these students in special education. And that's why I think I say to you very first and foremost, when you say special education, I say to you that special education students are general education students, because that's the mentality we have. We don't look at students and just call them special ed and these are general ed. It's like they're all part of one general ed environment, but special education students get additional supports, just like your ELL students get additional supports. And those supports are there needed And the hope is with the specialized instruction that they can come off of an IEP and learn the instructional strategies to use on their own.
Jablins, what is ELL? What is?
I'm sorry.
English language learners.
So for students who their first language is not English.
Sometimes called ESL. Sometimes.
The student is called ESL. Yeah. The program. The service is called ELL.
Yeah. But that's a good.
Right.
But that's a good question. It's a good clarification of that.
Students do come off of IEPs. If I can just take this opportunity, since you asked for things that we're doing differently, as you may have heard, thank you, Dr. Curie or Patty, for mentioning, there are no students that receive on IEPs that receive special education services that are placed out of district in the elementary schools. That was becoming a difficulty for Frontier because they could come up to Frontier, but we didn't have the supports and services there. So one of the reasons you see your out-of-district budget in Frontier now going down is it wasn't this year, but it was 2 years, last year? Last year, where we started a program for students with significant autism, maybe nonverbal cognitive disabilities that also affect behavior. And these were the students who would go to very expensive out-of-district programs. And now we have a program in Frontier. And then one thing you have to remember about these programs as well is not only do they prevent you from sending students out of district and they build the capacity of your school and your district, but they can also give you revenue because many school districts in our area don't have these programs. And they have to send kids out of district, and they call us and say, can we send a student in? And so we just got one of those phone calls today from one of our neighboring districts. Don't know if it's going to work out, so you can't just put it in the budget, but there's very few school districts that actually have as much tuition in that you have.
And one of the things we are doing with that, when we talk about being competitive, we have, Karen and I both belong to Franklin County group of SPED directors and business managers. And together, we are creating a database that the collaborative has agreed to host so that when other schools in the county need to go out of district, they're going to look at us first before they go to a 766 school. So we're building that utility so that we can all rely on each other and go to each other first before we have to go to an outside.
If we have an opening in the program, so if we develop a program for so many kids, it's not like we're hiring officials, then they can take that spot, not through school choice, because we don't make through tuition, and so we name the tuition.
Getting back to the elementary school, does that have a program as well that?
In Sunderland, every school except for Waitley has a specialized program, and all three programs are different, and Karen can tell you those.
Is Sunderland's revenue positive?
Yes.
Yeah.
Do you like to describe the program in Sunderland?
I just know you have a whole nother budget, so if you're really interested, I'll tell you, but I know that.
Do you want to get back to the
budget? It's going to come up.
It will, yeah.
Go ahead.
If I may. You said the out-of-district placement is very expensive. Rough order of magnitude?
It really varies, I hate to say this, it varies on the student, but I'd say anywhere from 40 to 110,000.
So you were saying earlier 104K is how much you could increase the budget. One out-of-district placement eats your lunch. I'm just, So it's one of these crazy things where it's like, it's not necessarily less expensive to run a bad school than a good school.
Theoretically, though, you get 75% back after $32,000 on a circuit breaker money.
45 now.
See?
It goes up every year.
Huh?
So you have to spend those up every year before you even get.
So that's why our circuit breaker money goes down, because the only time you really get it is when you have an out-of-district placement. Very few in-district children qualify or break the circuit. Okay, page 6, our student and staff data sheet for Sunderland Elementary. On the left, this year we're educating 257, and next year we're projecting 260. So we're about 3 off. Right now our kindergarten enrollment is running at about 35, which would necessitate 2 classes. On the right, you can see this year we're running with staff at 53.7, and next year we're going to need 57.8. And actually, it's going to be 57.9. There's a correction that I got late today.
So we're going to be going, changing positions. We're increasing by 4.2 positions.
Patty?
Yes.
I was just going down, looking at the numbers on each class and stuff like that, and just kind of, and then looking at your classroom teachers, et cetera. Mm-hmm. Where are we putting all the, where are we putting all the classrooms?
So
we don't have enough class. We're a few years ago we had open classrooms. Now doesn't look like we have a lot of a room available.
No. Well, and again, as Kim said, don't forget we built this as a K to six, and now it's a pre K to six. So not counting
pre K,
we have 12 classrooms.
I did hear that.
And with pre-K, we have 14, and with our out-of-district, with our specialized program, that's 15.
Yep, 15 classroom teachers. Mm-hmm. Where are they going?
We're very tight. Yeah. We absolutely are, and it's become tighter.
Is the principal moving out of his office to make more room?
Yes.
You're going to go in the boiler room?
We did have an outdoor classroom, so it's part of the playground here.
Well, to kind of piggyback on Tom's point, this is why this building use is important, because I think we need to step back and look at different solutions. And this involves other towns, but we need to step beyond the town borders and look at other things, like maybe moving one area where you have grades, you know, pre-K through one, OK and one, or whatever, and other grades. So that's why I just want to stress that's important.
Over the summer, they worked hard for very, very little money. They transformed a locker room into a room where the students receive specialized services like PT and OT. Mm-hmm. And that they did that in a locker room because there's just no room in Sunderland anymore.
And if you look at the current enrollment and the class sizes for fiscal year 18. Next year, grade 5 has one class. Next year, grade 5 is going to have one section. The following year, grade 6 is going to have one section. Then those sixth graders are going to leave. If we continue to get two sections of kindergarten in a couple of years, we're going to have another classroom, and we're pretty close to being maxed out.
That's a lot of kids for grade 6 next year. 31?
We had two classrooms, though.
Two classrooms.
So the way it's going to look for 2018, kindergarten is going to have two classrooms. First grade is going to have two. Grade 2 will have two. Grade 3, there will be one. Grade 4, there will be two. Grade 5, there will be one. Grade 6, there will be two.
Yeah, that's how I had it. I was just kind of writing
four. So you've got 26 kids in grade 5 in one classroom. You get three or four or five kids. You're over 30 kids there easily. And that happened last year.
That happened with last year's sixth grade class.
32 kids in grade 6.
We started the fifth grade year with 23, ended the fifth grade year with 24, and then by the time those kids were leaving sixth grade, there was 30. And the trend has been that each year, a couple years ago, we went into the summer with a projection of 31 second graders.
But you're picking up kids during the year. That's the problem.
That's the thing,
so,
too.
You start mid-year. The year with grade 6 in Mrs. B's class, and she's got 25 kids. In the middle of the year, she's got 30.
Right.
So your classes are growing even outside your projections, even outside what you can project.
Right. And it's such a transient community that, you know, Sunderland best, at least since I've been working at Sunderland, it seems to be the case every year where we get lingers.
It's the only town whose NESDEC survey is not holding true.
What's a NESDEC?
We, a couple of, 2 years ago, Marty Barrett
Secondary
had a
school administration,
NESDEC. It's a New England something. It's an
secondary education.
They did enrollment projection, and they said all four towns were losing kids.
We don't believe projections.
Sunderland's population over the years has always been up and down, up and down, up and down.
Sunderland's the only one that's not coming to fruition, because not only aren't we losing them, we're adding them.
Well,
some of the other towns, they're not losing them, but they're staying the same.
Yeah, but I think what you'll see with the other towns is with Sunderland is people my age are selling their homes. Younger people are buying the homes that have two or three kids in the elementary school.
Right.
And you went through a period where as the kids grew older, you know, so I mean, you're in a pinch now for maybe 3, 4, 5 years, but I think you'll see that start going down mm-hmm. in the future is past projections have shown.
Right.
And I think David's right is, you know, we got to start looking at excess rooms or space in other schools to be working with other towns.
I mean, it is, and it's interesting because we're always affected a little more because of the large percentage of apartments compared to like Deerfield or whatever. The only thing, the flip side is, of course, is you look at this region in the country, population is going down, but that's obviously one of the things we're trying to correct because that's actually not good, but there's a flip side to that. But, yeah, I don't know. It's.
But, yeah, we like to talk about projections, but when you, with the way that the population works in Sunderland, we've got the apartments, and you've got a lot of grad students, and you've got right. a lot of UMass attendees, and they come in, they bring their kids, and they're from China or Africa.
Right, you get a lot of international
kids,
students.
Well, you can't project for that.
No. Exactly.
You just move into the district, and you've got like 5 more kids.
We, our highest ELL population is here in Sunderland.
What happens if...
So I think the... How do you budget for that?
We have a full-time ELL teacher, and then we budget for tutors in language.
No, but I mean...
You're just talking the changes overall.
In general, how do you budget for the fact that you know... Your beginning, your fall opening day classes are not going to look like the way they look like in November or December or January. They never do.
They have this small round black ball with an 8 on it and a little window.
Well, I mean, it's just it's hard for them because so
it is.
So
yeah,
they're getting increased student populace
right.
that aren't they're not moving here and buying houses. They're like just showing up with kids from.
So you take this microcosm of Sunderland being that way and then expand that to a city like Holyoke or Springfield. So they're only ever getting money, and we here too, for how many kids we have on October 1st. So, and I'll give you an example from Holyoke because I worked there for 12 years. So on any October 1st, we would have about 5,800 kids in the district. But when we got to the end of the year, how many did we see over the year? Close to 7,000, but we only got money to educate 5,800. So, I mean, we're a much smaller scale here in Sunderland, but I do understand that problem.
But I guess my point is, it's hard for SES to budget with
correct.
This unknown increased populace every single year.
Yeah, and I think what's different about Holyoke is that we got the universities here, so it's...
It's a little less transient. It's more cyclical in its transiency.
Right.
And it's why we, I think, in recent years where we've been close to where we would go to classrooms and anticipating that it's highly likely we're going to end up at two classrooms. So we might as well open that to choice so that, you know, we get some revenue and still have decent classroom sizes.
But then you can bump up.
That can be a risk because you can actually end up with such a bump of students that you even with you would be better off maybe of not having choice in
that's
one classroom.
That's my question though. Is there a chance that we can run out of room, just not have the space for the children? I mean, what happens say mid school year? We get a bunch of kids that arrive, but we don't have space for them.
Well,
what happens?
That's an interesting question, Francis. But if you look at the class size, okay, kindergarten has 35 kids, so that's two classes, 117, 118.
Right.
I don't think that's over subscription of children. First grade is 36 kids. That's 18 a class. That's over not over subscription of children. You
so
got 37 in grade two.
What
that's,
number is the maximum for?
Are you talking?
They're looking 22 to 24 from years past.
Say it again?
They're looking at 22 to 24 as on top of the class size.
Our lower grades, kindergarten 1-2, we like to keep them a little smaller. 4, 5, 6 can go a little higher, but on average, based on your projections, our average school, our average class size for K-6 is 19.
Yeah, and that's what it looks like in your numbers that you have here.
I think Francis is talking physical size as opposed to.
There's a difference between the preference and the requirement. What we've been following over the past couple years through school choice is that in grades K through 2, we're trying to cap class sizes at 18.
Why?
So that means
that makes sense.
It's a lower number.
I can see.
Teaching 18 students at the kindergarten level is significantly different than teaching 18 students at the sixth grade level, just with the needs. So
we actually make an argument
for kindergarten.
Yeah.
You could, absolutely. But for regs, and Kim, correct me if I'm wrong, for kindergarten, they can go up to 25.
That's right. And the state defines high-quality kindergarten currently with 20 students in, one main teacher and one instructor. Hot off the press.
So which means that we provide a much higher quality education based on the numbers that you guys educate in our classrooms.
Yeah, I know where you're going with the number, because if the number is 20 is a high,
exactly,
and we're working with, say, 15.
15, 18, that means we have a much higher quality product.
Right.
Product.
Right, if you go by the state's numbers, exactly.
Right. So these are the kind of things that I think people need to know. Look, I am out of the game of children. But I see many young people who young parents who think that their kids are better off in a town like Amherst, because of, I don't know, I think people need to know that we actually have a very good product in this town, or in this
area. We do.
How big is your sales and marketing budget?
I think people in town do know that, and school choice out at the elementary school level for Sunderland is either 6 or 8 students right now, which is significantly low. So I do feel like people, the townspeople, appreciate the work of the Sunderland Elementary School.
What are you pulling in, Ben? 48 kids?
Mid 40s. 46.
We have 46. Oh, let me tell you what we have now. We had 46 in October, and I have your enrollment sheet right here, Ben, for this month.
I will just add.
We're still at 46.
I have, just to answer a little bit about that. I went through and I did an analysis of, and we call it NEWA, which is Northwest Education. It's a standardized test. It's called Measures of Academic Progress between the fall and the winter scores in Sunderland in math, and every single grade had increased the projected growth expected, and they're meeting the norm of the students across the country. And that's in mathematics. So, and I didn't get a chance to tell them that.
Well, you're high quality teachers in the building, so.
Yes, sir.
If, say, you get too many students in a classroom. Can you tell the school choice people I can't be school choice anymore and tell them to leave?
No.
Once you get them, you're stuck with them.
Once you're in, you're in.
All the way to 12th grade.
So maybe we might be better off to say no more school choice and bite the bullet, fund the school like it was maybe 15 years ago, 2 teachers in each classroom.
Bruce, you've got a finance control board.
Why don't I continue, and when you see these numbers, you may be thinking the difference.
You did?
I had 3.
Oh, but you know.
Well, that's what Deerfield has done.
Right. You know,
and what happened, and I understand what you're saying, but what happened in Deerfield is that when in-town population went down, school choice numbers went up so that they would maintain those sections, and they ended up getting into a little bit of trouble where that third section, that third class at each grade level, was created just by school choice, and fiscally that wasn't responsible or sound. So here, we're paying very close attention that if we're only accepting school choice at the grade levels, if a class can be filled, not created.
Which is why you mentioned that the seventh grade is not.
I think
so in certain years, you're projecting, say you have 40 kids in a class, okay, in third grade.
Yep.
So you won't accept any more school kids into that grade until that number goes down.
School choice.
Correct.
School choice, yeah.
Correct.
Right.
The The exception would be a practice if you have a Sunderland family who moves out of town, Sunderland family moves to Deerfield, but wants to continue to enroll their students
here
in Sunderland.
Sunderland.
So that the number's not changing, but the school choice number would.
Right.
So they stay.
They maintain it so that it's revenue positive.
Yeah.
Right.
But it seems to me the solution is you get two teachers for each class size. And then you stabilize everything instead of adding teachers, subtracting teachers going forward.
Even go back to Tim Merritt. It's always been a juggle. They've always tried to.
Yeah.
They've been trying to do that, you know. It's that.
But they're bouncing teachers
balance
around, you know, from one classroom
like
to the other
one. I like
one
teacher
one
per class.
We went through this probably 15 years ago, 20 years ago, and finally we got two teachers in each classroom. And that lasted for 3 or 4 years or 5 years. Mm-hmm. And then they started cutting, and that was not the thing to do.
Because when the override did not pass and we had to cut the school budget, your parents went with their feet and they chartered and choiced out. And now we've got them all back finally.
And I wish we learned that lesson, because there's some that put up big billboards on the signs of tractor trailer trucks along Route 116. I don't know who that would be, yeah. But it was tried to be explained at that time that we would lose school choice kids, and they said, well, we don't believe it. We need to see it. I hope we don't have to go back and pull the data out to show what happens when you lose school choice, because.
But we can, though, if we have to.
I think it's been shown that if you don't provide good education, your kids are going to leave. Not only your school choice kids, but your kids from this town are going to go. And guess what? They can take their kayaks across the river and put a hiking shoes on and walk to Whiteley, and Whiteley has plenty of room for Sunderland school choice kids. So.
Right.
Yeah. Right now we're like this, or you know, whichever you want to say is it, and it went like that.
Right.
We're back to like this. You know, we could go through that experiment again, but it was obviously very painful. So.
Well,
the experiment.
Real estate values will start getting affected and everything. So.
All right.
If we go to page 7 of 28.
Yes, let's go.
Only 21 to go.
Everything we just talked about, we are asking for a large increase, $185,663, or 7.81%, to keep our school intact, level serviced. And some of the reasons are the contract, again, the steps for $23,317. The 2.5% cost $39,935. There was a new degree added to the contract for $5,135. Lead teacher stipend was negotiated for an increase of $1,100. We had to move $23,700 off our school choice budget. We are asking to increase our custodial time by 0.4 so that we have two full-time custodians. That will cost $7,956. We had to add an instructional assistant for $23,789 and an allowance for the increase in non-union salaries of $3,950. So our salary-related increases are $128,882. The central office percentage is $58,716. So first, it's because you went from 16.13 to 18.43 again. You're the only one growing, and the rest are decreasing. They're not even staying the same. The other part of this large increase is that we lost some grants that were funding some of our curriculum people. Our elementary curriculum director was partially paid by Title I because of the last census. Massachusetts is getting less money, and then because Massachusetts is getting less money, Sunderland's getting less money because we have to get in line with the free and reduced pool.
Quick question. The central office cost, that's our percentage of it. How much did the central office cost go up overall?
You don't have that with me.
Okay.
I'm sorry, I didn't bring that. But the other big piece that went up is we lost all the kindergarten grants that were playing a large piece of our early childhood director, Ms. McCarthy, who's with us tonight. And then we did have some decreases because we did close 219 Christian Lane. But I
don't have that. I didn't need to quantify that. And then again, the increase to the central office health insurance, again at 80%, also brought us up. And I wish I brought, that's the one, I brought everything that everybody else asked me for in every other meeting, except the central office budget in totality.
Does the, did the line items, is any of the central office being paid by other sources? Because then the line items would cover.
No, there's no other sources.
Well, we know there was a decrease in Frontier's office expenses, 0.02%.
Increase because you have to move through the loss of.
You have all that new room at Frontier, so you need to fill it up, huh?
Well, no, this is a decrease because we lost two grants.
We could send some kindergarten classes up there if you need.
The kindergarten and the elementary curriculum coordinator onto, they're part of the central office. So they get a piece of each of the four schools, but they're part of central office. And those two salaries have increased essentially.
Frontier doesn't get that piece because they're elementary.
Yeah.
So that is the only split between four and five. So that's the additional reason. So not only did we lose funding, but those positions are only divided by the four union schools, not all five, because they're elementary positions.
Whatever decreases you had for moving the central offices, is that account for ongoing decreases, or was that just a?
It was a conservative decrease for the first year because we don't have any experience running an empty building. So we're hoping for 19, it's going to decrease even more.
Right.
And then depending on what happens with 219 Christian Lane, we'll also determine what the cost will be.
Do you own that building?
We do.
And we're working now, we're actually meeting tomorrow morning. We continue to meet with the building subcommittee to discuss what we're going, in the long term, what we're going to do with the building.
It's in pretty poor shape, right?
Well, I mean, it depends on how you look at it. It's not fire safe. It's a great shape if it's not a public building, but it's not fire safe. It's not ADA accessible. There's no elevator, there's no lift, there's.
Just disposing of it on the agenda.
Can we give it back to Whately?
They have the right of first refusal, and I think they're going to be refusing.
Then why don't you?
Oh, they said they're not interested.
Yeah,
oh, surprise, surprise.
But we'll see. There's some other.
Maybe we can make some Frontier condos.
Boy, when they gave it to us, it was such a great deal for the district.
It would be nice, though, I think, for...
That was a white elephant.
In a larger
I think
context.
We said that at the time, but no one listened. Anyways.
For people to see the decrease in costs.
You were here. You were here.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, what happened is that the Frontier was here. When Whately built their new school, they said, hey, why isn't there a competition? You should put it out to bid. So we put in our bid. I was on the select board at the time, but we put in our bid, which was $12,000-$15,000 a year, which we always are charging. They said zero for the first 3 years and utilities over there. So they put out the RFP, so then they had to take it. And that, I'll tell you what, that zero for the first 3 years, that was the best deal the people Whately ever made, because shortly after that we got $500,000 to fix a carrying beam and windows and.
Well, the business manager was from Whately.
Go figure.
Yeah.
Well, anyway,
this one's from Hoyle.
Oh, we ain't moving down there.
I have no vested interest anywhere.
But it was here.
The buildings down there.
It was a seamless move, and I believe everyone is happy.
That makes a lot of sense.
Like
Thompson, get rid of the building. Let it be someone else's headache.
Yeah.
You know, put a sign up, get an auction in there, get rid of it.
We got rid of the old Sunderland Town Hall for $1. Best thing we ever did.
What?
I'll take
note of
that for
$1. Get rid of it.
He's on the committee, so.
You know, we keep these old buildings and they just go into disrepair and everything else.
Yeah. Might suit a dispensary nicely. Who knows?
You know, just give me an excavator. I'll take care of that.
All right. Back to our budget.
What to do, Tom?
Huh? I got an asbestos screw. We can take care of it.
There you go.
We have to increase increase the budget $1,350 for our collaborative dues. This is not a new expense, but one that was unbudgeted and paid for on a grant. We can no longer pay for it on that.
Was that Ben's pocket change?
No. So I'll be here 5 years in August, and every year I'm still finding things that we don't budget for. So when does it stop?
That's a good question.
General supplies, we're asking for a $2,000 increase due to our increased enrollment.
Cut.
Our SPED support services, $3,000. Our softwares, $14,764. Our IT director, his first year here, he focused on the hardware. His second year here, he focused on the softwares. We found all the softwares that every school is using for every possible purpose. We've identified them, and we've reallocated them based on the types of softwares that they are, whether we allocate it based on number of students, number of teachers, number of devices.
Do we team up with the other schools in the region?
Yes, we do.
In the district for purchasing and everything for the software?
Absolutely. So, but unfortunately, Sunderland's share needs to increase $14,764. Some of our special education students require transportation monitors, and that'll add $2,059. And professional development stipends, $1,650. Per the contract, $600 a year for a teacher and $50 for an IA. And this just gets us to the minimum with the number of staff we have. We did decrease our heat by $10,000. We did a 3-year analysis of what we actually spent. So we think that we can cut the $10,000, but I'm still a little leery about that, but we're going to cut it. And then the retirement buybacks, $16,758. We had one teacher that retired last year, none in the forecast as of now. So anyone that announces, if they announce now, we don't have to budget until FY19. So that'll decrease to $26,758 for a net of $185,663.
What about the solar, the offset for that? How are we
Sherry
doing
told
that?
Me
we're waiting.
Yeah,
yeah, we're working with Kearsarge and right. Beth to get numbers. Yeah.
So we'll see a little effect on that.
Yeah, the first so couple of years
year
are going to
we'll
be kind of.
Cut, yeah. So the next few pages 8, is just the through 16 are the detail. Of that summary page, which is the town appropriation. And then if you skip over to page, page 25 of 28, this is all our funding sources. So we're asking the town for $2,561,853, which represents almost 80% of our budget. School choice will spend $425,493. Our early childhood revolving $20,000. Now, hopefully, we will get more money than just right now. It funds $20,000 of our EC teacher. We did not increase the estimate for tuition because it's our first year, and we just want to make sure we are going to break even with the extended day before we start adding more revenue as far as spending. So next year, that might be that will definitely, hopefully, take a bigger hit. Our Horizons will spend $136,613, Title I, $15,806, and our SPED IDA grant, $63,616, for a total budget of
$3,223,381. If you go, can I just say right there, when you say Horizons, I just wanted to be clear to people that that is money coming in from tuition.
No, this is money spent. From the tuitions coming
from
in.
From the tuitions.
Yes.
So the reason you can spend $136,613 is you have students from other districts tuitioned in, so you have money coming into.
Okay. And we'll look at that on page 27. So if we look at page 26, this is our school choice. Now last year, we did forewarn you that we weren't going to be able to continue to have everybody on there that we did. And this year we moved almost $24,000 off. But we are now no longer spending a year in arrears. We are spending everything we get in the year that we get it. So at the end of June 30th of 18, you can see I'm only projecting a $35,000 balance, which is what we use for our contingency in case we do get a move-in student that has high sped needs. And then next year, if you look, our anticipated revenue for 18 is 349. So for FY 19, it's going to be about the same. But these, we're spending 425, and that number is going to go up. So you can see what we're going to have to move over in 19 is an excess of $100,000, which is, again, going to have to come over to the town appropriation budget because these are all services that we need. This is funding classroom teachers, no teacher specialists, instructional assistants, and our ESOL tutors. Page 27 is our special revolving, our special education revolving fund. This year, we're projected to bring in $128,318 in revenue, and we'll expend $140,000. So we'll start 18 with a balance of $2,246. We're projecting to bring in tuitions of $150,000, and then we'll use that money to pay for some speech therapy, some physical therapy. The OT, that number should read 20,149. That goes with the correction I made on the first page.
Say again, please.
20,149.
For the OT.
For OT, we have an increase of 0.1 FTE. Instructional assistance, 62,938. Assistive technology, 4,000. Our autism consultant, 10,000, which will then change our projected ending balance from 15,633 down to 8,917.
917?
8,917.
Thank you.
And I will make sure that Cherry gets corrected sheets for you.
Thank you.
So we know that that is a very large increase to request. Our public hearing is tomorrow night, and the school committee will vote the budget tomorrow evening.
Generally, at the public hearing, how many people do you get to defend it?
None, unless Mr. Pierce comes.
Okay. Public hearing?
For Sunderland?
Effectively,
We've had quite a few at times.
And sometimes, you know.
Last couple of years we haven't, but.
Even
20. There's at least going to be two people there.
Since I've been here, we've never had more than maybe five.
Right, Dave?
Your first year, we had like 20.
And we had it in the cafeteria. And then since then, we've been in the library.
Yeah, not enough.
It's an ongoing issue.
Are the parents involved in a PTO and stuff like that? I mean, they're the ones that got to get organized to get things to happen. I mean, that's the way it was in the past.
We have a very, very active PTO.
More people that show up at the budget hearing, I think it bodes well for the school committee and everybody else. And you have to get the community support in going back to when we passed the big override in 93 or 94, you know, the PTO was very, very involved in that and getting the people out to vote for it. And that's how you got to do it.
I think that's tough with the budget hearings. I think if there was a sense of concern that the school committee didn't have the parents' interests in mind, you know.
You still need that public support to show the other townspeople that the people are supporting it.
So we need them at the annual town meeting, not so much at our public hearing.
But you need them all the way through. You got to get them on board.
Right.
Yeah.
Folks at annual town meeting, they don't even. There's no discussion on the school budget. You know that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know, we spend 60% of our budget on the school, and we don't.
It's even higher than that.
I think I've answered questions. I think I answered one.
But it's you got to get that community support, and you know, the more people you get there,
How are you going to get into there?
It's up to the PTO and everything, you know.
I mean, I think they should come to the town meeting. We don't want to have a discussion, but they definitely show. I think it's that burnout. I mean, people are doing, I mean, we have a very active parent community, you know, in the schools and doing a lot. And I think so, one more meeting where they, I know, it's like, especially if they feel like, okay, you know, feel like this budget, you know, what I've here is reflecting our interests.
But it's a continuation when it goes to whatever it goes to down the road for a vote.
Well, exactly.
And that's
when
what,
you get into
that's
the
what
reality
the key
of
to
the
it
situation
is.
For the town as a whole.
You're talking about building momentum.
To play devil's advocate, though, we should also have people who aren't involved in the schools at the budget hearings as well.
Absolutely. And you should have the other side of the story of you know, why we don't need the money.
Right. But you look at the regular meetings here, how many people show up?
Yeah. Yeah. I have a question.
The only time they show up is when it hits the wall.
What kind of volunteer
you know, I'm calling spades a spade now, you know? And that's fine.
I can start to tell you.
I bet you do.
Netflix.
Yeah, exactly.
I
mean,
what's that? Ed
wants to go to meeting.
We have a very active board of PTO members and five or six parents, and at the beginning of the year, we send out a list of all the events that take place throughout the school year. Parents volunteer and can sign up for some, for a bunch, for just a couple. It might look like providing baked goods for the sixth grade bake sale, but we have an incredible volunteer effort from our parents. And some of that is reflected when we did the playground build a couple of years ago, where we had an outpouring of support. Some of it looks like volunteering at our community service day that we have each spring for Sunderland in Action Day, when we do projects out of campus and around the town to just teach the kids about civics and taking care of where they live and go to school as well. So I would say it is a pretty active parent community. And there's varying degrees of how active each person is.
Do you ever try to recruit non-parents into our...
We haven't done that a lot, and one of the things we talked about through our school council was possibly having some student broadcasters at times, and having that go on FCAT TV to kind of promote what was going on at the schools. But no, we haven't had a lot of non-school parents involved.
So I have to ask a question of the select board and the Tom. So previously, if I heard you correctly, Mr. Feigenkevich, you're saying that your increased revenue for FY18 for the town is $141,000?
Plus new growth, yeah, which is about $20,000.
Okay.
Give or take an hour.
These two schools were asking for $211,000, and I don't know where your Franklin County assessment's coming in.
Right.
Have you met with them yet?
Uh-huh. And our Smith vocational also.
Mm-hmm. So are you going to be able to support this?
I don't know. Well, I would. We haven't discussed it. But I just have a theoretical question. Last year budget increase for Sunderland Elementary was 10.8%.
Right. That was to bring us to next school's funding.
This year 7.8%. So now we're looking at 18.6 over the last 2 years, and that does not include the dreaded health care and those outside of things that you guys don't even see, that we're already experiences, and that you, well, according to this, you have, what, 57 employees next year?
Right.
And to speak to that, minus the custodian position, which we're looking for the 0.6 to move to 1.0, so that we have two full-time custodians, those 57 are our current employees right now. That's not saying over the summer I'm gonna hire four more employees. Since the current budget was approved last year, we've added those positions to meet the needs of the students.
So, well, what I was getting at is that most of your positions are full-time, and I don't know if they take or don't take insurance, that's not the discussion. Mm-hmm. But I mean, outside of our I mean, we have, if you look at total number of employees outside of the school, it's very small. So the school, I would say the school probably at least 50% of our, if not more. So while your direct is an 8.6% increase over 2 years, if you look at the indirect, it's probably, to the town size, probably another, well, we know it's 10% this year. So probably another 5%. So you're looking at you're looking at like 23-25% increase over 2 years just for Sunderland Elementary.
And the 19 is not going to be any better because we have another 2.5% increase negotiated. We have $100,000 we need to reduce from school choice, and we don't know what the health insurance is going to be in.
Right. So I'm just saying. I asked last year, and I didn't say you had to do it, but I said, you know, that 10.8% is an awful high. Even if you take away that 8% to get us low 10%, it would be a really nice gesture, and you guys chose not to do anything. I disagree with that. Personally, that's my personal assessment.
But we legally had to spend that to get this Chapter 70 money.
I understand that. But what I'm trying to say is that if you go to the average person, the average taxpayer, and they look at a budget that's increased now 18.6% in 2 years, your tax bills are going to go up that much. Okay, so at some point you have to say, are those, or should, you know, and I'm and speaking off the cuff, should we say, okay, let's take let's let the residents of Sunderland, Finance Committee, you may want to listen or may not, but should you take it and do a 2.5 override just for Sunderland Elementary School, and put the elementary school and say, hey, look, we want to do another $186,000 plus the indirects. Should we go just for a year? And I heard we've had and David kind of said it earlier today. What about the other employees that we have? What about our police? What about our fire? What about our other positions? How do we fund those other positions? Right now, you don't have money. There's no money left for those positions. I don't want to pit schools against the town because I think we're all one. But at the same time, other places taken, you know, look at David just presented earlier about the wage reviews. You know, our employees are starting to fall behind because we're paying for other things. So,
go ahead. And then I have some comments. I
was just going to say, from a business model, we've developed a product to meet the needs of the students at Sunderland. And if we didn't offer all the programs and services that we have, those students would be going out of district, and that 8% would be jacked up much more. As Karen had alluded to, that sometimes when you're sending students out of district, the cost can be between 40 to 100 plus thousand. And so when we're looking, if we do have that magic eight ball in it and are able to see the needs of the students coming up, the staffing reflects what we need to meet those needs of those students.
We didn't do anything. I remember sitting at the table so much with Marty and Ben trying to figure out what to do. And so not only is your school choice money going to be hurting and isn't there anymore, but in many of the other schools, this Fed revolving account builds up and you actually have money in there in case you do have an out-of-district student. Every year that was built up, it was come back to use that to use for personnel. And every year we say it's a one-time fix. So there's, you know, I just feel like there's no money in school choice. There's no money in Fed revolving. Your student population has increased by 45 students in the last years. The needs of the students.
That's a lot of students.
Well, it's
in the last three.
We went from a low around 170, right. I think it was. We're at, and I'm not sure if that was K through six. Well, even K through six, we're at 233. That's 60 more. Pretty sure it was one.
And the needs of the students that are coming in are much more severe than they were 5 years ago.
You know, when you talk about the transient population, I have to disagree with you. Maybe I'm way out there, but I don't believe the apartments are the cause of the big increases coming and going. I mean, if you go by the apartment complexes when they're waiting for the kids to get on the bus, you know, there's maybe 6, 7, 8, 9 kids out there. Well, it's been 6, 7, 8, 9 kids for the last bunch of years. And I think that's part of what you have to look at is, from my point of view and from what I'm seeing, it's residents in town.
Young families moving in.
Young families moving in. Like I said, you know, I sold my house. The person that moved in there got 3 kids. All school age kids, you know, so it went from 0 to 3.
And next door neighbor sold their house and they have three school age kids.
Yeah, and I mean, that's right, and that's happening, you know, 2, 3, 4 houses. Back when we were building 20, 30 houses a year in town, it was the same thing. You know, those populations went up, and that's what you got to look at.
We looked at that a couple of years ago, and roughly half of the students who came in were moved into the apartments, and the other half buying houses.
Yeah.
So I don't know what it was this year, but that was either this week, last school year.
And then the apartment kids generally move out after they get to like 3rd or 4th grade because the parents move on to other jobs or whatever, you know.
So, but we have another large complex that may be coming online in what fiscal year here?
Well, we can't talk, you know, that's down the road.
Yeah,
you know, that might never happen.
Okay. So it's definitely not going to happen in 19.
Okay. So I have to add this, okay? Sometimes you can't be afraid of the discussions. And it's important that you have the discussion. So when you go to town meeting or budget hearings or whatever, or you meet people on the street, that you can ask these questions. Our job people sometimes ask how this board, why do you guys always have 3-0 votes? And I go, well, that's pretty easy. He said, what do you mean? I says, that we usually talk about things forever, but we usually talk about things forever, and sometimes David comes in with one position, I come in with another, Scott comes in with a third, and we go through our discussions, and I change my mind, David changes his, and Scott has a totally different idea. But it's we meet someplace in the difference because we're not afraid to have that discussion. So, when I'm not saying it, I agree or disagree with the budget. That's right now. That's my we're trying to ferret that information out. I'm just saying if I'm a person that in the economic recovery over the last year has 8 years has not affected everyone the same, and there's still a lot of people that are out there working for the same rates that they were working 8 years ago or less. Some people don't have jobs, and some are less, absolutely. And to tell you the truth, I don't see the next four years. We may have an economic, but I don't know that, and so you have to ask, what's your average taxpayer looking at right now? And when they hear an 18.6% over 2 years, that hits them. And I'm not saying you guys haven't done everything possible to get the budget where it is.
But I think what it reflects is we were doing so much and moving mountains for years after our budget cratered.
Yeah.
And of course, student population left, but that actually was also hurting us financially because it was choice, and it was so we set the choice money going out. We did things, amazing efforts of a lot of people, got kids back in the school. Our population in the school has increased. I'm certain it's more than even probably the nominal dollars that is increased since that low point. Let alone if you then factor in some inflation. So we're still paying less per student now than we were then.
Yeah,
Less than the state average.
But at least with the assessment. And so what we did was, like, we did things like maxing out the choice in ways that we can't do forever. There were some grants that came along. We did other things. And we're running out of that, and we're trying to move back to a more sustainable budget.
I love your position, Doug, because you made my point that I tried making an hour and 45 minutes ago when we talked about using $157,000 out of E&D and $100,000 out of thing. And what I said is that, to me, that's not good budgeting, because those are non-reoccurring funds. Now, what we've done is we had school choice monies available. It was always a year in reserve, and all of a sudden we started picking out of that. Well, we got to use school choice to make this year, make this mix. Well, guess not. We don't have a year. We don't have a tenth. Right. We're using all thing. Our sped revolving, we used to have money in sped revolving, but we started using all sped revolving. So now we don't have those cushions anymore. Sped, that's what I'm saying.
Third year
you have tuitions.
Right.
But that's what I'm afraid of has happened with a Frontier budget. The same thing. We're going to use 157 out of E&D this year. We're going to use 100 from school choice, and all of a sudden we won't have those reserves.
I have a question, Tom. What will you have them cut? I mean, what area are we looking at that we can discuss cutbacks on from what we just saw? I'm just curious.
Oh, Francis, I don't know. I have, I'm not, look, Dr. Kay, we have a superintendent of school, we have a principal, we have business people. They're the people that look at the budget. You don't want me running the elementary school. I can take a steam distribution line from here to California, and I'm fine with that. But don't ask me to come up with a budget.
In response to what you're saying about the school choice funds, you were asking us to come in low with all those years when the money was, when the town didn't have money. You were asking us to come in with 2%, 3%, use the school choice. So now we're at the ball. I mean, it's not like we did this in amongst ourselves. We did it in response to the town's needs for us to do it.
Oh, I'm not. No, that's not. I'm not questioning. See that?
No, I think you are, because you're saying now you hit a wall.
You picked away at your school choice. See, you just told me earlier, unfortunately, that you're the only town that said we shouldn't be using that $157,000 out of E&D.
Right. I'm talking about the elementary school.
Sunderland's the only town, right?
I'm talking about the elementary school now.
I think I've been very consistent my whole time. You put a good affordable product on the table, and you have to define affordable.
But I'm going to go back to last year. That 10.8, you wanted us to come lower. We couldn't. We underspent required net spending in FY16. Our budget was under for FY17. If we did not bring our budget up, the state wasn't going to give you any Chapter 70 money.
$6,000.
No, it was more than that.
Well, right now we're paying 80% of our bill.
Well, when we talk about budgets, though, when I know last year I wasn't on the finance board, and it was a 10.8% request, and this year it's 7.8. When you add those two together, it's 18, and it's again about perception. When you add those two together, it looks really, really bad. It looks like the school budget is blowing up. But it's also about need.
But I think, again, if you took a two-year picture, right, if the need, and
you know,
and over a longer period of time, if you blow that out 10 years, then and how much the budget has changed and how much the population has changed, throw in need and inflation.
Are we serving more kids or less kids?
Next year's three more kids.
How many
more
kids? Our budget went up so much last year was because the town did not have to spend the charter and
over this term year, three kids.
Yeah. But that wasn't seen in our budget. That was seen on the town side.
So,
but I think all the philosophies
aside, conversations, I don't think in these, and you've consistently raised the point for sure about we're spending money that
we don't have.
We can't rely on.
Correct.
And that has been out there, and we've consistently been saying, okay, you know, our choices here are either we rely on it this year, or, you know, cut a teacher, or we, you know, or some program, or some other really hard decision this year, and or you know, go with this year, and we might, knowing that we might have to make a painful decision the following year. If
we didn't have those monies that, I'm sorry, I'm able to call, but those monies that you mentioned, is it a sped account? And what was the other one?
School choice.
If we didn't have those buckets of money, and we still have this number of kids, then what?
Okay, so the state, based on the number of children that you are educating, it's called the foundation enrollment. They come up with the net required amount you have to spend. And if you don't, and that's what happened to us last year and in 16. Part of your required net school spending is what the town pays in charter and choice out. So 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, we were paying a lot of money for choice and charter out. All of a sudden, the kids started coming back to us. So we weren't getting the money in the foundation enrollment, we were getting it in the charter and choice out, and it flipped. So that's why last year we were short in 16, because we didn't pay what we were expected to pay in charter and choice out. So we fell below the minimum. And then when we did our budget for FY17, we were notified that that wasn't going to make the minimum either when they did the when they gave us our numbers. So it's just a shifting of where the money's coming from. I don't think that we're spending anymore. It's just that now our kids are wanting to be educated in the building over there rather than in a choice or a charter school.
The charter reflects on where the charter doesn't reflect on. I mean, yeah, right. The charter.
We have no kids in charter.
We have zero
right.
Kids.
Right, and
in
when we did have kids in charter, it would hit the town,
right,
not
the
school
town,
budget,
right.
Right?
Exactly.
So if you
school
so,
choice
if you take what the charter outgoing
and choice
and choice
and choice
choice hits the town, not the school.
So if you take those out and put it against the increase that of the assessment budget for the school,
right.
It's a different, you're talking about a different number, right?
We're not
so how we impact it?
One second.
No, just, you know, again, I agree. We don't want to be afraid of the conversation. But in terms of talking about the big picture, I'm absolutely right. There's the cumulative erosion of rainy day funds that have hit a wall, and also the funding drying up from grants. That it's not as if the schools have decided to spend lots of money that hasn't been spent before, but now we have to go to the town to get it, because other places have dried up, and that needs to be part of the conversation too.
Well, right, and I don't think the current political climate is going to improve that situation in any way, shape, or form over the next 4 years. And regardless of, in a way, for a moment too, you have to put aside philosophies and everything else and just look at raw numbers. If you just look at, just like you were going over, so can you support that? And if you just look at raw numbers, the numbers aren't there to support that. So then the question becomes, how do we deal with that? I mean, because balancing a budget, that's easy. You can throw a worksheet together and it can balance a budget, but that's not how we balance budgets. And for a moment, you have to put aside whether that's meeting the need or not. The reality is somehow we have to figure out how to make it work or get an override. I mean, and that's why, too, it's really easy to disintegrate into arguments back and forth about things. But in the end, we have to look at the numbers and say, okay, is this what we want to support? And then, you know, we can do it on the committee levels. But then that has to be extrapolated out to the town. And like Tom was saying, if we're, you know, you look at, let's just look at Sunderland Elementary for a second. Like he said, too, it, oftentimes it gets forgotten that not all of the education costs are directly in that budget, because some of them are borne by the town separately. So that's why, and when you add that all up, you're looking at between 65 to 75% of the overall budget. And put aside any judgment on it, that's just a numerical fact, is in the education area. So that if that goes way up, then we've got to sit there and make a decision as a town. A, do we support that? And then if so, okay, are we going to pay for it? And that's, I mean, and it's largely, a lot of it is, once you make that decision, then it's a marketing campaign. Let's face it. And we've all been here before. That's kind of what we're starting to stare down the barrel of. And it's only going to get worse.
So I'm just looking at it from this perspective, David, is that usually we're here earlier. Usually we're here meeting with you in February.
Yeah.
And right now, our meeting is tomorrow night, and then we have a joint meeting on the 5th, and then we have annual town meeting on 28th.
Right.
So if this isn't going to be supported and we need to be making changes, we need to have that communicated to us as soon as possible so we can do what we need to do to
Understood.
Meet whatever needs you guys need us to meet.
Understood. We come every Monday night. Yep. We're here.
But it's not.
So are we going to cover it? Do we us. Any more new ground? New ground?
Hmm. Personally, I think you should go for the money and get the support of the parents and everything else and go from there.
Yeah, just watch out for that guy with that tractor trailer truck.
He's tough. With the parents, if we have the approval of the finance committee to recommend our budget, that goes a long way.
Well, I think you should go for your budget. The school committee recommends the budget.
I think it would be another good number to see, but if we can pull it together tomorrow, I think a lot of the stuff is the net. Like if we did the net with that outgoing choice and outgoing charter over the last whatever years,
that would help.
Factor that in with our budget, our assessment budget, and look at that.
Also,
increase, I don't know if it would even be an increase in our budget and what we've been asking
for. Well, if we're
going
to do that, I need to get home because I'm in my 16th hour of being awake and my 10th without any food, and I have to go to the bathroom. So,
and I hate to say it, but like some graphics would help in trying to make the case, too, in terms of something that displays like the percentage of your budget, think pie charts, what percentage is labor versus fixed expenses, and also capital. I mean, none of this really got into capital.
No.
And that's... also a looming beast.
We haven't asked for anything for the owners.
Right, but I'm just saying that's something that, you know.
All right, so we have any more new
you
ground?
You have to be able to take care of
it. I think the cost per student, what it was 10 years ago versus 5 years ago versus
right.
now.
That will be a useful piece of info.
And I think that would be very important mm-hmm. because I think you'll probably see it going, it's going down. But you got to get the grassroots support. That's where you got to go.
And the percentage that, along with that, that the cost too, like you show that number, and then the percentage of what the local, like the town, a given town is kicked in versus the state, and how that's changed over time.
But I don't have that data. I mean, I've only been here 5 years. They just moved me into a new building. I wouldn't even know where to go find anything past what's on my computer.
Just do your best shot, Patty. You know,
check out the state website. They got gobs of information.
Well, I'm looking at that.
All right, so are we covered?
2014 now.
We can have some of these discussions offline. We don't have to do them right
but
now.
But you got to stress you're producing a good product. I think that's the key to it. The product you're putting out is very good.
It's about marketing. The children.
That's
what's about the children.
We're still paying less than the state average.
Right. For FY16, that we just got our per pupil. Our per pupil in district is $13,606. The state average is $14,995.
I think for a fee, Bruce would come on and consult for you guys for marketing, you know?
Okay. Did you hear any more?
Fee's real high.
That's okay.
All right. Thank
those consultants,
you
got to make some money, right?
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you, Doctor.
All right. Discussion points don't change, huh, Doug?
No, it's
a you can't, but you can't be afraid. You can't be afraid to have the conversation. Because through the conversation, people learn.
Like,
so.
Yeah. Like if you want to get like
the conversation, then people
whatever something happens. Check with this wonderful woman next day. Yeah. I think it's a new election.
That's the point. Yeah. I do that.
Is it too late to get a
town meeting warrant?
Oh, you have, right. And you can't specific.
No, they haven't signed it yet.
In my opinion, when someone throws out a number like 8.7% or whatever, right? And if you just say that number and people don't understand what makes up that number, people have to understand what makes up that number. If you understand what makes up the number, then you can have an informed decision. That's what you try to get, but sometimes people think it's...
You're welcome.
You're trying to give the everybody the best benefit to explain so people understand. So All right, so.
As it turns into Washington, keep eyeing over the front.
All right, so we have approval of minutes of 3/13/2017.
Thank you.
Anytime.
Minutes.
Motion?
Motion.
Have a motion made and seconded to accept the minutes of March 13, 2017. All those in favor signify by saying aye. Okay, I'm going to skip over updates. Unless you had any major updates, Sherry? Resignation letter?
Yes, I have here. This is from George Emery, dated 20th of March. George, I must regretfully inform you that I am submitting my 2 weeks notice of resignation of my position at the Sunderland Highway Department. An unforeseen career opportunity has arisen, and I cannot afford to turn it down. I'm very grateful for the experience I have gained during my time here, albeit brief. I wish you and the department the best for the future. Thank you. Sincerely, John Santos.
Okay. Motion to accept with regrets.
Motion.
New highway
guy.
All
those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye on them, then you said quit now, right?
All those in favor say aye.
Because it don't pay well. Aye.
What?
2-0. Memo from the highway superintendent.
Let's see. Yes, this is from George Emery, also the highway superintendent. I'm looking for the select board's permission to fund the repairs to the FL80 Freightliner through the snow and ice budget. Due to the large amount of heavy wet snow in such a short period of time, the plow sander truck sustained damage to the rear hub and 3 tires had to be taken offline. The damage was caused by plowing and sanding during the storm on March 14th and 15th. I spoke to the accountant this morning, and he stated that since the damage was caused by the unusual amount of snow in a short time frame, that the repairs could be paid through snow and ice with the board's approval. I do not have an exact amount for repairs at this time.
Yeah, I'll accept a motion to accept, George, to do it contingent upon. We just have final say when we get to the final numbers. But we'll get them anyways because it'll be over the, you'll have to ask for an increase of deficit spending.
Yeah, okay. Motion.
So we have motion made, seconded. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Next selectman's meeting, 3/27/2017. We also have a Sunderland Elementary School budget. It's tomorrow night. And there's also a capital meeting tomorrow night as well. So anything else we need to talk about?
And building committee, if somebody wants to go tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock, I think it is, about the old
okay. We have thing. A building committee also. Anything else, Davey?
Frontier is Wednesday, their budget.
I think we had a good, I think, you know, some people may disagree, but I think the conversation was good.
Yeah.
And I think those conversations are all.
It's important stuff.
It is. If you anticipate, people shouldn't be afraid to have that open conversation. So, any more discussion on anything?
No discussion.
Okay. Motion.
Motion to adjourn.
Have motion adjourned. I'll second. All those in favor?
Aye.